You know, bees are amazing. Watching them is like watching ballet. And I learned something about bees this summer in our garden from our tomatillo plants. Tomatillos, you know, they make the paper tomatoes that take the husks off and make beautiful green salsa from. So good. But it turns out, I didn't know this, that tomatillos need a friend. They don't self-pollinate. They need another tomatillo to pollinate with. And that pollination is done by bees and other insects. We had several tomatillos here, which did really well in this part of the garden. But then we put one way on the other side of the garden, just by itself. And it wasn't making tomatillos. It was covered with beautiful yellow flowers like tomatillos make. But the flowers just weren't turning into tomatillos. And then I read, oh right, tomatillos need a friend. And the bees weren't doing the job because apparently these tomatillo plants were too far away from there. Maybe the bees were lazy, I don't know. But I decided I needed to do the work because I wasn't paying the bees. We don't pay for the bees. So I took a little flower from one of these plants. And I went over to that other plant and I went all around like this, bringing that flower right up into the other flowers. And then, a couple weeks later, it made beautiful tomatillos. Me, as a bee. Zzz. Come with me while I pollinate. Buzz, 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 buzz. And that's what we call ecosystem services. You know, lots of what we depend on in agriculture and in our daily lives, we don't pay for. We don't pay for it because no one owns it. Pollinators, sunshine, rainfall, the air we breathe, floodwater regulation, these are public goods, not private goods. Buzz, 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 buzz. These are all ecosystem services, an idea which is often extended to even include cultural matters like the sense of beauty in the wild or the gorgeous, gorgeousness of the red color of this pepper. Scholars have tried to estimate the value of all of this. There was a 2014 study that found that the value of ecosystem services is $125 trillion a year globally, which is actually as large as the world economy, more or less. The trouble is, worry many, that if we don't pay for things, we won't value them. We should pay for them, say some thinkers. We should have PES, payment for ecosystem services. The issue here is what economists call externalities, matters of the public good that we don't take into account when making decisions in the marketplace. Payment for ecosystem services would make these internal to the market, or even make them into markets themselves, paying people for serving the public good. And maybe along the way, we can save the family farm. Farmers would get paid for multifunctionality. Organic agriculture might be especially valued here because of the ecosystem services it provides, like clean water, protection of the soil, habitat for wildlife and pollinators, food unpolluted by pesticide residues. I understand the instinct here, but we need to be cautious. Most notably, money is actually a notably poor measure of value. Lots of what we care about is actually really hard to put in monetary terms. What is the price of beauty? What is the value of justice? What should health cost? What should be the price tag for a year of life? That difficulty is in part because many things are actually hard to own as private goods. Some economists try to price these things by seeing how much we pay to get them, like how much you'll spend to take a trip to Yellowstone to see Old Faithful. Determining revealed preferences, as they call them, through surrogate markets. That's what they call these ways to price things. But there are some real troubles with this approach. First, value is many splendored, and the really important things are not reducible to a single gradient, like relative price. Beauty, justice, health, life. How can you reduce these things? Second, money is power. So if we put everything in terms of money, we're reinforcing inequality. Pretty much everyone needs the same amount of air, say, over the course of their life. But imagine if you had to pay for that, say, $100 or even $1,000 a week. That wouldn't be much burden on the wealthy, but huge for those who don't have much. Is that fair? Some thinkers, they argue that markets are a form of democracy. So people would basically be voting on the value of ecosystem services if we turned them into markets. One example of that might be the organic standard. If you care about getting your ecosystem services, pay for it. You should be willing to pay double for milk, right? But that means the wealthy get to vote more, because if $1 is one vote, then they get a lot more votes. Is that fair? So that's a third issue. Markets are not democracies. And fourth, do we risk turning doing good things into a form of blackmail, kind of holding everyone hostage, essentially paying farmers and others to do what they ought to do anyway? The sun, the air, the soil, wild pollinators, these are common property that we should protect in common. Well, say some, we can't manage ecology like commons because we get along so badly. Garrett Hardin made a famous argument about this, what many see actually as an infamous argument, as it is seductive and yet also deceptive. He coined the phrase the tragedy of the commons to describe where everyone abuses common property because they don't pay for it. The logic goes like this. Sheep herders on a commons selfishly each maximize the number of sheep until the whole thing erodes away because of overgrazing. Hardin said, well, that's the basis of all environmental problems. Here's the deceptive part. The tragedy here is individualism, not the commons. And turning everything into a market may just be amplifying one of the basic causes of our troubles. Thinking about the private good and forgetting about the public good. Again, the basic insight of agroecology, and maybe the basic insight of organic agriculture too, is that we are not alone. We live in context. We depend on context. And what we do shapes context. So, thank you, bees. But can I give a special shout out to the bees that do my raspberries? Because there's too many raspberries for me to pollinate myself. Thank you, bees. And I sure love my raspberries. Here's a nice one. Mm-hmm.